Vineyard has a remarkable, staggering variety of natural resources. I mean, in the sense of its flora, its fauna, and above all, the proximity of the water. It's thrilling to come here and sense all these things in a wonderful mixture.
I like to come here in the fall and the winter, and sometimes by myself. Because as soon as you get here, everything, all the tension goes. All the tension goes. You read, you light a fire, wintertime. Summertime, it's difficult to explain what kind of peace this place brings.
It has gorgeous beaches here along the South Shore, absolutely gorgeous. And it has the most beautiful sunsets. We have traffic jams, for Chilmark traffic jams, down in Menemsha, who go down to look at the sunset. Absolutely so beautiful, looking over towards the Elizabeth Islands, looking over Vineyard Sound. A very special, special place.
Nobody who hasn't been has any idea what the heck it is, because Martha's Vineyard conjures a picture in your mind that is not what this place is. People don't know how big it is. People don't know. They think it's, you know, they think that Kay Graham lives next door and I borrow sugar from her. Walter Cronkite comes over and he sails his boat in my bathtub. This is the kind of things that people think about with Martha's Vineyard.
I felt a really strong emotional connection to the Vineyard, and it's hard to even say where that comes from. I'm sure a lot of it has to do with being an island. An island is such a unique place.
There's no industry here. There isn't any pollution. We really don't have any crime here. People hitchhike. It's a very common thing. You know, nobody has any fears of anything.
In Martha's Vineyard, everybody is the same. You know, people come over and talk to you. Nobody has any respect for position. What they do have respect for is privacy. People do leave you alone. In fact, the very fact that there are probably lots of people who in the real world are well known is a protection here.
I like the fact of it being an island, the island mentality, and the fact that you have to plan to get there and can't just drop in is, I think, a very appealing part of it. The isolation that's an island.
Because it was my childhood home, it became the roots. And it's been the major place in my life that I have felt rooted to, that I've felt a connection to the soil, I've felt a connection to the people.
It is a most unusual human landscape fitted into a physical, natural landscape of extraordinary beauty. And to put these two together gives the Vineyard, I think, a character that, and an identity and a sense of community and place that is quite apart from anything most people experience elsewhere.
From the long stretches of beach that surround the island like a warm sandy blanket, to its rolling hills and farmland. From the Federalist-style whaling houses that remind us of colonial New England, to the colorfully decorated gingerbread cottages that seem to have sprung from the pages of a children's book. From the rows of stone walls, to the lush forests, to the sailboats that play along its shores. Martha's Vineyard is a very special piece of the American landscape. A place where the character of the land and the people is rooted in diversity, and where their spirit has been bent, but thankfully not broken, under the weight of progress and modernization.
We are trying to avoid making it like every other place in America. We are trying to avoid the strip mall development. We are trying to avoid the fast food franchise places. We are trying to avoid stoplights at every intersection corner on the Vineyard. We are trying not to become simply like any other piece of suburbia in America. We are trying not to pave over this place. We are trying to protect very fragile resources that, after all, is the attraction of the Vineyard. People do not come here to experience precisely what they are experiencing at home.
Martha's Vineyard is located at the southeastern corner of New England, just below the shoulder of Cape Cod in Massachusetts. Unlike Nantucket, the Vineyard is part of the Elizabeth Islands, which spread out away from the Cape along the southern Massachusetts coastline. Travelers to the Vineyard can fly, but most come by way of the ferries, which make repeated trips from Woods Hole to Vineyard Haven throughout the year. During the peak traffic and calmer seas of summer, the ferries run additional trips to and from Oak Bluffs as well.
The first thing I remember about the Vineyard is getting on the ferry over in Woods Hole, maybe 60 years ago, and naturally, you were excited about taking the ferry over to an island in the Atlantic Ocean, but the gulls were circling all the way over. The smell of the salt, the spray, looking down, if you could, at the prow of the ferry. This is the memory that has stayed with me more than anything else through the years.
Basically, everybody comes to the island at Vineyard Haven. That is not a town of any physical charm because it all burned down in the 1870s. And everything that is there now, everything you see when you come into Vineyard Haven Harbor, is basically fairly new. There's none of the history that is available in either Edgartown or Oak Bluffs.
Before the Cape Cod Canal was constructed, Vineyard Haven was a favorite stopping place for merchant ships that made their way along the trade routes of the East Coast.
Vineyard Haven Harbor wasn't unusual to see 300 vessels anchored in here. It was a harbor refuge, major harbor refuge on the eastern seaboard for the coastwise freight traffic which went around the Cape and, of course, through Vineyard Sound.
Today, Vineyard Haven is still home to one of the largest contingencies of wooden boats in the country. Vessels like the schooner Shenandoah and others, both large and small, view Vineyard Haven Harbor as a safe and convenient port from which to set sail around the island or around the world. The Black Dog Tavern, which is located directly on the waterfront in Vineyard Haven, was opened in 1970 as a sandwich and chowder shop to serve residents as well as visitors to the island. Since then, the Black Dog logo has become a true Vineyard icon and a symbol that's recognized from coast to coast and even internationally.
There was an old fallen down boathouse where the Black Dog now stands, and we always said, gee, what a perfect spot for a restaurant. Well, nobody had the idea it would turn out like it did. And as far as the, I think we finally were talked into produce T-shirts around 76.
Because Vineyard Haven is home to a large number of Martha's Vineyard's year-round population, it maintains the warmth and charm of a small New England town throughout the year. In fact, at Christmas time, even Santa leaves his sleigh in Woods Hole and takes the ferry to Vineyard Haven.
For me, there was an attraction about Vineyard Haven because the rest of the year I live in a very rural part of Connecticut. It's really farm country. Does not have a sense of small town community. Whereas Vineyard Haven does have that small town quality, which I like. I like to get up in the morning and walk down and get the newspaper, that sort of thing.
A bunch of us, the Styrons, Art Buchwald, Wallace's, friends of ours, have all bought plots in the cemetery that's just about 200-300 yards up from here. And originally, Artie said, look, if you're gonna get in there, if we're gonna let you be buried there, you know what I'm gonna put on your stone? Here lies Mike Wallace. He was always a renter. Well, under those circumstances, he simply had to buy a house.
But the thing I like the most, I want to make this point, is the dress code in Vineyard Haven. Nobody cares what you wear. You go to Eggertown, green pants, and a lot of whales. They love whales on their clothes.
During the 18th and 19th centuries, Edgartown was known extensively as a whaling community. But although the whaling industry figured prominently in the economy of the island, Nantucket was a more frequent point of departure for many of the great whaling ships of the day. Martha's Vineyard played a much more important role in servicing rather than actually participating in these expeditions. Edgartown was filled with merchants and business people who made their living by selling or trading supplies to those in the whaling community. The beautiful white houses along the water that were built by whaling captains and by wealthy merchants long ago are still beautifully preserved today. They line the streets of Edgartown with their widows' walks and their manicured gardens filled with all varieties of flowers. Flowers that seem to bloom during all but the harshest winter months.
It is a very low-keyed island. It's not like the equivalent in France would be Saint-Tropez with discos all night long. Nothing like that. The island is really rather staid and conventional. And people are coming here for excitement and kicks are not going to really find it here. And that's all to the good. There's no doubt about that.
On Independence Day, the 4th of July parade is an Edgartown tradition. It's an event that brings the entire community together and reaffirms the spirit of freedom for vineyarders of every generation.
Year after year, we've gone to the July 4th parade over in Edgartown. Some friends of ours, the Icards, have a home that's right on the route. Talk about old-fashioned middle America. That's what it is with the fire engines and the floats and the Camp Jabberwocky bus. It is community. It is community, and there's a great sense of community here, great pride in community.
And here's Henry! Henry, baby!
I got
And somehow, each year, the talented and creative group from Camp Jabberwocky manages to outperform everyone else and win the title of best float in the parade. In the center of town stands the old whaling church that was built in 1843. It remains a focal point for the community and a host to meetings and special events. Even President Clinton delivered his radio address to the nation from within these walls when he visited the vineyard. The Clinton vacations on Martha's Vineyard drew a great deal of media attention all over the country, but nowhere was the coverage more intense and comprehensive than in the Vineyard Gazette, Martha's Vineyard's oldest and most respected newspaper.
I think the Gazette is a very accurate mirror of an extraordinary community. It is probably, for example, the only community paper in the country that goes to subscribers in every state in the Union and some 26 countries overseas. And again, that is really a unique reflection of the kind of community the Vineyard is.
Edgartown abounds with the marvelous reminders of our past. Beautifully maintained symbols of a small but grand New England town.
You can say it's small, but you know, it's a great thing. People care about each other. And because of that, you know, we don't operate at the same speed as the rest of the world. We sort of have our own little system and our own speed here. And because of that, you know, that's what makes this unique.
The streets are filled with dozens of small gift shops, art galleries, and restaurants, and with accommodations that range from cozy inns and bed and breakfasts to elegant hotels. All just a few short steps from the water. During the mild weather months, Edgartown Harbor is alive with activity. Boats of every size and type occupy its waters, sailing and motoring past the Edgartown Lighthouse, which stands at the mouth of the harbor. In the evening, an orange hue bathes the entire area as the sun sets behind the sailboat masts and the steeple of Edgartown's Congregational Church. Chappaquiddick, the easternmost part of Edgartown, is just a 2-minute ferry ride away from all the hustle and bustle. The ferries On Time and On Time 2 can carry up to 3 cars over to Chappaquiddick and back. Chappaquiddick, which is essentially a peninsula, can also be accessed by 4-wheel drive vehicles along the eastern portion of South Beach. Chappaquiddick has some of the most beautiful wildlife and scenery on Martha's Vineyard. It is a bastion of serenity, an unspoiled wilderness. Here, fishing is a passion, and whether you're a seasoned pro or a beginner, it's difficult to be here and not marvel at what nature has created.
The vineyard's beauty, I think, is deceptive for many visitors that come here. Like so many resort areas, there's a kind of a herding aspect. Everyone goes to the same place, and then they worry about how crowded it is, etc. But they do not, they don't take long enough, many of these visitors, to reach out into all sorts of other areas of the community where there is no crowding. This is a much bigger place than people realize, I think. But the trick is to get people off the beaten path, to let them see some of this other extraordinary beauty that this community has in a way that most other communities do not.
In 1969, Dyke Bridge on Chappaquiddick was the site of a tragic accident that took the life of Mary Jo Kopechne, tarnished the reputation of Massachusetts Senator Edward Kennedy, and propelled Martha's Vineyard into the national spotlight. After the accident, the bridge lay dormant for a quarter of a century until it was rebuilt and reopened in 1995.
Even in spite of the Kennedy tragedy in the late 60s, which drew so much attention to the vineyard, in some ways for the first time nationally and even internationally, and there was the Jaws experience. But the 70s were still rather a quiet period. Then we move on into the explosion of the 80s. And that was a real battlefield. Things ran out of control. There was the seizure of the South Beach, for example, by developers in the 80s, which took a whole stretch of the Atlantic coastline and for the potential of heavy development and easy, quick, and enormous profit. That battle was fought. We were able to get the part of the Atlantic face of the island back. The state moved in, took it by eminent domain, and today it's back in public hands. It was blocked.
South Beach in the Katama section of Edgartown is one of the most popular beaches for visitors and island residents alike. The long shoreline, warm southern waters, and easy access make it ideal for sunbathers. Behind South Beach, a little bit inland, are the calm and peaceful waters of Edgartown Great Pond. Cow Bay in the northwest section of Edgartown is a very small strip of land which sits at the head of State Beach. Its private cabanas overlook, on one side, a small pond that's home to various species of waterfowl. And on the other side, the inviting waters of Nantucket Sound. As you head away from Edgartown towards Oak Bluffs, the long rows of brightly colored flowers create an exquisite natural barrier between the road and State Beach. In the summer, this stretch of beach is a family favorite. You can park your car on the side of the road empty its contents, and walk just a few feet to the docile shoreline. Swimming here is exceptional because the currents are generally much milder than on South Beach in Katama. One of the famous scenes in the original Jaws movie was filmed around the wooden bridge and the jetties on State Beach. Today, it's still a fabulous place to fish, but the catch is usually quite a bit smaller. Experienced windsurfers also delight in this particular section of shoreline because of its ideal wind conditions and mild currents. Senjikatakit Pond, across from State Beach, is extremely popular with cyclists and rollerbladers. Senjikatakit's warm, shallow waters are perfect for beginning windsurfers, and since the pond is sheltered, there's great comfort in knowing that even if you lose control, you won't end up in France. On calm vineyard evenings when the wind subsides, the pond becomes a glassy reflection of the western sky. Nature lovers can walk the trails of the Felix Neck Wildlife Sanctuary, which borders Senjikatakit on the Edgartown side. While Farm Neck Golf Course, where President Clinton played during his vineyard vacations, borders the pond on the Oak Bluff side. Traveling up Beach Road towards the center of Oak Bluffs, picturesque scenes like this one in Harthaven are as close as your outstretched arm. At the far side of State Beach, near the Oak Bluffs ferry dock, you can try your hand at parasailing or jet ski alongside the ferry boats. There's so much to do in this one small area that even Vanessa the sea serpent and her baby return to this spot for their summer vacation each year. For the less adventurous, canoeing on Lagoon Pond can be a quiet, relaxing experience.
There's a place at the head of the lagoon that if you drive by at noontime on a, you know, average day, you would never even look twice. I mean, it's sort of a pretty scene, but it's not distinctive in any way. And yet, spring or fall, when you have warm days and cool nights, and early in the morning, if it's really still, there's mist on the water. It can be, it just transform it and come alive, and the sun comes up and comes through the mist, and at that moment, that's my favorite place. I've been shooting the same place, you know, the same island, 21 miles long, for 20 years now, and the main thing that changes about it is the light and the weather that creates new situations and new pictures. So I'm really kind of impossible when I'm off the island. Remember a couple of years ago, I was vacationing in Key West, and it was in February, and it was glorious, about 85 degrees. We were sitting by a swimming pool, literally pulling limes off a lime tree and, you know, putting them in our gin and tonics and floating around in the pool. And someone had a copy of USA Today, and they were reading about, oh, look, there's a blizzard in New England. And it says in Woods Hole that the ferries aren't running because it was so bad. And I was sitting there, I wanted to be here. I didn't want to be there at 85 degrees in Key West. I wanted to be on Martha's Vineyard in the middle of a horrible blizzard.
Because vineyard winters are generally milder than they are in the rest of New England, snow is a rather rare commodity that arrives less frequently and melts almost immediately. Oak Bluffs has been proclaimed by many as the playground of the vineyard, the town most frequented in summer by day trippers and the younger generation. Its colorful trappings and honky-tonk atmosphere afford Oak Bluffs an altogether festive and bohemian character. Located on the island's east chop, in contrast to Vineyard Haven, which is on the west chop, Oak Bluffs began, ironically enough, as a religious retreat. It was a meeting ground that sprang up around the Methodist Tabernacle, where today special events like the Vineyard's high school graduation are held.
It started as a religious place entirely, a camp meeting. And then people began to come, summers especially. And instead of the tents, they built houses like the tents. They turned their tents into houses. That's why they're so small and so close.
On Martha's Vineyard, there are no building codes, or at least the building codes aren't that strict. Whereas on Nantucket, you go to Nantucket, and all the houses are gray shingle with white trim, or gray slat with white trim. And it certainly prohibits a lot of bad taste from happening. But it also keeps your, you know, it keeps wonderful imagination from happening. You'd never have the wonderful gingerbread houses that you have in Oak Bluffs with a building code as strict as that. And you have a wide variety of styles and tastes here, just as you do with the landscape.
In Ocean Park along the waterfront, there are often open-air concerts during the summer, which the public is welcome to attend. And in August, rather than on the 4th of July, the park is host to a spectacular display of fireworks. Oak Bluffs is also famous for its Flying Horses Carousel, the oldest of its kind in America, where the brass ring still exists if you're fortunate enough to grab it.
If you look at pictures of here from the 1800s and you look at pictures of here now, you really won't see that much difference because they've maintained that integrity so that things don't change. And you won't see the neon signs, you won't see the Burger Kings and McDonald's, you won't see all the things that went along with growth on the mainland. And by keeping us, you know, in the traditional ways, it's maintained its beauty here. And that's a great gift of all the town fathers to us who live here.
As you begin to leave Oak Bluffs and head toward Vineyard Haven, one cannot help but marvel at the delightful visual collage that's been composed in harmony by man and nature. West Tisbury, in the center of the island, is the most rustic of all the vineyard communities. Although it's only minutes from the ocean in any direction, the land is dominated by farms and ranches, with grazing livestock, and fields of flowers that splash the countryside with color.
When I married James Taylor in 1971, it wasn't my choice. Again, James had bought the land. If I had had my druthers, I probably would have lived by the ocean, or I would have chosen to live by the ocean and maybe regretted it later and then moved inland or something, because being on this land, which is inland during the winter, is quite comforting. You're not looking at the deep, dark, dreaded blue sea all winter long. So because this is a year-round residence, it is kind of nice in the winter. This landscape is quite hilly. Inland, you can't tell on this property that it's on an island at all. You can't, I mean, if you dig down in the soil, you'll see that it's fairly sandy soil, but that's probably one of the only ways you'd know it was Martha's Vineyard. Unless I told you, which I'm inclined to do.
Animals like the longhorn cattle have been imported here from other states, but they appear to be completely at home behind the stone walls of the island. Walkers along the back roads of McConaughey and Pilot Hill may stumble on a work of art that was created solely from the palate of the earth. In Lambert's Cove, the wooden pathway leads you to the water's edge, where waves wash gently on the shore, and puffy clouds are nothing more than idle decoration. Horse farms like Arrowhead near Indian Hill abound along the tree-lined pathways of West Tisbury. But horses cannot claim West Tisbury as their domain alone. At Takami Farm, for instance, miniature donkeys are nursing their young during the long, hot days of August. The children who visit are in their glory here. Where else could they find a donkey to play with that's no bigger than they are. Besides the donkeys, llamas roam the yard as well, mingling gently with the other animals and grazing to their heart's content. The man-made pool at Takami Farm is brimming with numerous varieties of ducks and geese. They play in the murky waters of their protected pond. Some even strut haughtily around as if to draw attention to their flamboyant markings. In West Tisbury, the farmer's market is a summertime tradition. It takes place each Saturday at the site of the old agricultural hall.
The farmer's market, just a few years ago, was a market where some farmers came and they sold their nice lettuce and radishes and a few bunches of flowers. And when the peas came in, you could get that. And when the corn came in, you could get that. Today, it is a happening.
I come to the farmer's market because, A, that's where I meet my friends. I mean, you know who's in town Saturday morning by when you come to the farmer's market. Second, you know, we live off the farmer's market. We buy the pesto here, fresh made. We always buy the fresh flowers, the fresh vegetables. You find out what vegetables are in season. You know, there are great people who make wonderful things like vinaigrettes and everything. We wait for the corn to begin. It really is a way of saying, what time is it of the year?
It's truly a wonderful way to sample what the rustic side of the island has to offer. Near the old agricultural hall stands Alley's General Store, a vineyard landmark since 1858. It's said that Jacqueline Onassis visited Alley's store quite often from her home in Gay Head when she needed a few odds and ends. Directly across from Alley's store is the Field Gallery, an outdoor exhibition of modern sculpture that playfully reflects the whimsical personalities of many of the island's residents.
My wife, who was deported last year, had an exercise class on the lawn here, and all the women in the neighborhood used to come over and do the Jane Fonda exercises. And it was 9 o'clock in the morning. They did it from 9 to 10, and then they were allowed to have gossip for a half hour. So then I bought that statue there because it was a perfect statue for the Jane Fonda exercises. And I named it Our Lady of Fonda. I named it after Jane Fonda. When my wife died, the people on the island wanted to give a memorial. And they said, don't have it in church. Why not have it on your lawn? So all the exercise girls came with their mats, and we played the Jane Fonda exercises. People said words and everything. And you couldn't have had a better memorial. So that was very sad. I am very sentimental about this island, and I don't mind saying so. We all have had losses in Washington. When my wife died, it was very tragic, and it hurt. But I didn't let go until I came up here, and then I started to cry. And it's the first time I cried, because this house is associated with happiness.
In 1995, a new agricultural hall was built in West Tisbury. In order to help finance the project, Carly Simon and James Taylor were asked to give a private concert on the vineyard that summer. The concert was called Livestock 95. And the fortunate few who were there to see it say it was a vineyard experience they'll never forget.
I feel like a concert on Martha's Vineyard is like stepping out of my bathroom into my bedroom. It's sort of like going downstairs. It feels as if the islanders are my family, and as if it doesn't feel at all threatening to me. And I do have a problem going out on stage because of you know, feeling as if it's me and them. But on the vineyard, I don't feel that it's them. I feel that it's me and us.
The agricultural fair, which is held on the vineyard every August, is a marvelous time for everyone in the community and a glorious spectacle for visitors to the island. There are competitions for dogs of every breed imaginable. Ribbons are worn with pride, and prizes are not handed out without a great deal of deliberation. Livestock like the draft horses and the cattle are shown and judged at the fair. Of course, the standout event is the lumberjack competition, which is becoming more and more competitive each year. Finally, no trip to West Tisbury would be complete without a visit to the duck pond. Traffic problems here seem to have a very simple solution. Always brake for ducks in the crosswalk. Can you imagine this in New York City? The town of Chilmark is recognized for many things: its sunsets, its beaches, its forests, and its ponds. Its stone walls, however, are a man-made wonder. The stone walls of Martha's Vineyard are not unique to Chilmark, but nowhere else do they seem to be displayed as splendidly as here. The walls meander along the roads and through the fields, dotting the landscape like some fashionable accessory on a fine piece of clothing. The walls were built primarily during the 18th and 19th centuries, when the mild wintered vineyard grew enough sheep to feed and help clothe much of the northeastern United States.
There are these rolling fields and sheep and horse farms and the most beautiful beaches you ever saw. And a kind of a different culture, in a sense. Up there, it is self-consciously, if you will, laid back up there. I mean, this is pretty laid back as it is, but when you go up there, people want space.
A lot of the people who have country homes in the real world tend to go down island for the more urban life, and those of us who live in the city in the real world tend to be in the more rural section in the summer. I love visiting people in the cities, but for me, Chilmark is the real island.
Chilmark has the mountains of the vineyard. Two enormous mountains, each over 300 feet high. I think there are 307 and 310, something like that, feet. Once you're in Chilmark, you have reached the right place. It is less crowded, it has a beauty, and has trees, forests, that you don't get in Gay Head.
When you're up island, you feel like you're a million miles away from everything. So up island is to totally get away, but you know, that's where you find yourself fishing on a beach with, you know, the sun going down on the horizon or coming up on the other horizon. Or you find yourselves at a barbecue when you're so away from everything that there's a bond of everybody there, that it's a real camaraderie.
We used to go down there with all our children and some of our Ralph's brother's children, and there'd be maybe 15, 20 kids running around, and we'd build a fire and we'd cook corn and hot dogs and hamburgers and swim in the surf, and then we'd watch that fantastic Chilmark sunset. The magic still works because our children come every year. We have six of them. And summer is not complete unless they spend some time on this island. And so that means it's working for the next generation. And now our grandchildren are starting to come. So I hope it'll work for the generations to come.
The ponds that line the southern side of Martha's Vineyard create a unique experience for many of its beachgoers. In addition to the marvelous ocean waters, there are the waters of the ponds to tantalize and lure away even the staunchest saltwater enthusiasts.
I think the whole southern length of the island with the great ponds, the Edgartown Great Pond, Tisbury Great Pond, Chilmark Pond, all those ponds along the South Shore are uniformly, to me, beautiful and very unusual. They're all glacial remains, sand plains. It's where the glacier ended and trickled out into the water, and then when it retreated, it left all the rocks everywhere else on the island.
The rocks and boulders of Lucy Vincent Beach in Chilmark are reminiscent of the rocky coast of Maine. But rest assured, the water temperature isn't. The Vineyard was a favorite retreat for John Belushi and his entourage. After his untimely death, Belushi was buried in Chilmark on his beloved Martha's Vineyard. In Chilmark, as elsewhere on the island, there is always a tremendous variety of flowers that seem to bloom constantly. It's not uncommon to travel along the road and find a bouquet of wildflowers in a coffee can with a sign that asks you to take the bouquet and to leave $5 in the can. The Chilmark store is a favorite rest stop for bikers and joggers who crisscross the island on their way to Gay Head and back down island. It's a terrific place to pick up some refreshments and perhaps catch up on a story or two with your neighbor. The tiny fishing village of Menemsha, which faces out toward Vineyard Sound and the Elizabeth Islands, is actually a part of Chilmark. Visitors flock to Menemsha in the summer to sample what is perhaps the freshest fish in the northeastern United States. And although fishing is still a major part of the local economy, most of the large fishing boats that were anchored in Menemsha are, at least for the time being, gone.
In the fishing industry, the government stepped in a little too late to put quotas on different fish, so a lot of the fishing boats that were in Menemsha have now been sold because they just weren't making enough to pay off their boats and things. We're hoping that the government and putting quotas will bring the fish stocks back up. But until they, you know, start enforcing rules and regulations for foreign countries, our stocks will never build up either. And so a lot of them have gone into much smaller boats or just seasonal fishing. We'll have crowds and crowds of people here at night that come to see the sunset only. And as the sun hits the water, you'll hear whistling and clapping and car horns honking. To me, it's kind of almost an everyday occasion seeing it for 40-odd years. But people year after year come just in the evening to see the sunset. And they'll, you know, buy lobsters, have them cooked, take them to the beach to eat. I love going off island for the day, but it's always a thrill going down the Woodsall Road knowing that I'll be on Martha's Vineyard within an hour, where there's always something going on. And so I like the peace and serenity in the wintertime. But I also like the hustle and bustle in the summertime, yeah, because I know a lot of people count on it for their economy. And you know it's only going to last for 3 months, whereas you've got the rest of the year to recuperate.
Gay Head, which makes up the far western portion of the island, has what is undoubtedly the single most recognized landmark on Martha's Vineyard: the Gay Head Cliffs. The community here is comprised of a very diverse but extremely close-knit year-round population.
One of the things about Gay Head is in the winter and the summer, it's not a heck of a lot different. At least our community isn't. You know, because we don't have a big commercial district and we don't have a lot of day trippers and stuff and pedestrians, you know, sort of accessing our community up here, it's things go on fairly similar summer and winter. They don't change much.
Gay Head has some of the most beautiful, unspoiled shorelines on the entire island. Because much of the terrain is so rocky, rock sculptures are not an uncommon sight along its beaches. Fishing, clamming, and scalloping are a part of the lifestyle in Gay Head during the summer and the winter, and well worth it when the day is done. The cliffs are not the only natural wonder in Gay Head. Its southern shoreline maintains a fairly long expanse of dunes, which form a natural barrier between the sea and the ponds. Here, the population is fairly sparse, so landmarks like the multicolored house have become a part of the island vernacular. Sometimes, you might not see a soul for miles as you explore the shores of Squibnucket Pond and consider how a place as small and at the same time as diverse as Martha's Vineyard came to be.
The whole vineyard is made up of a big glacial deposit, mostly brought in from the New Hampshire and stuff, I guess. And there's like four or five fingers of melting and receding glaciers that really sort of stopped in this area. And the Gay Head Cliffs are really like the bow wake, the big berm of the sediment that was on the seafloor in this locale that was pushed up by the weight of the glacier as it was moving slowly out to the south and east. And so this is actually the indigenous soil of the area right here that makes up the Gay Head Cliffs. And that, well, obviously the clay is a sediment, so it is the seafloor. And it's always sort of liquid, and no matter how dry it feels to your hands, so it's just sort of sagging like our facial skin towards the sea, you know. Gravity's got a hold of it, and it's gonna erode, there's no doubt about it.
The Gay Head Lighthouse stands above the cliffs and overlooks the outermost inn on one side and the Aquina restaurant and gift shop on the other. The views of Gay Head's beaches from the Aquina are breathtakingly beautiful. Still, it would be naive to think that everything about the vineyard is unspoiled. There are a number of concerns that have to be addressed as we go forward toward the year 2000.
There is the celebrity aspect of the island, which I don't particularly like. You know, when all of a sudden you see movie stars who would not be here if it weren't for the fact that the island is famous, then you know there's something going on, you know, and that the going on is not entirely to the island's benefit. This disturbs me a little, but I think the island will survive it.
It didn't used to be cool to come here, or if it was, you never really thought about it. That was secondary. You came here because you loved it, the same way I'm here because I love it, or anybody's here because they love it.
The battles today to preserve Martha's Vineyard are much more savage, much more complex. It's really, at times, almost a bloody battle to protect this place.
We're suffering sometimes from gridlocks in a lot of the towns. There's just too many cars. And I really think that what the island needs to do is figure out some sort of mass transportation, so to speak.
The great misconception is that all you have to do is drive to Woods Hole and get on a ferry for a 45-minute ride. So many people think it's just come on down and get on the ferry, and it's not like that at all.
We made a big mistake, I think, when we bought into a lot of big new ferry boats to bring over lots more cars, without investing or giving any sort of forethought at all to public transportation. I think we really need public transportation here. So we have to figure a way to let the people have access to this place and still be able to get around without an automobile.
While I'm in the real estate development business, I think that real estate development poses a great threat to the vineyard. and that we've got to try to figure out how to get more diversity in the economy here.
We are saying, yes, come here, visit us, and you will have a different experience. And if you give the vineyard a chance and you don't wreck the place, the vineyard will return to you all sorts of rewards that you cannot imagine.
There's something that everybody can say, oh, this reminds me of Ireland. This reminds me of Connecticut. This reminds me of North Carolina, the Outer Banks. This reminds me, you know, in other words, it's something, it makes everybody feel at home in a certain way because it's reminiscent of something. I wish more places were reminiscent of this island.
We talk about this place all year round. For 10 months, we talk about the 2 months we're gonna have here. And people like Mike Wallace, he lives for the 2 months. And it grabs you.
I don't know, there's something, I hate to use the word magic or therapeutic or whatever, but it's that's what it is, truly.
You're just completely hooked. I mean, there is really, if you come here, it talks to you right away, I found.
We all focus on a certain love for this place, and that we build from that and make our sense of community from that. There's a real great quality of life here, there's no question about it, but unachievable in other places.
Just having, you know, the quality of air, the quality of life, the beautiful ocean out there, gorgeous landscape, I'm sure there are a higher percentage of people who are happy here than in most other places in the country.
This is home. This is my home. It always has been my home. It always will be.
I love this place. It's a great place. It's the best. Just don't tell anybody about it.
Henry Beadle Huff, who used to have the Gazette when he was alive, sums the whole thing up in one sentence. Martha's Vineyard, next stop, there isn't one.
Swings lower and touches the grass. The apples are ripe and the corn is past. Everyone says summer goes by so fast, and we just got here. We just got here. We just arrived. I can hardly believe it, but it's ending. The beach is a haze and old love's a ghost. Hugo is twisting his way up the coast. If you blew out to sea, I'd love you most. And we just got. We just got here. We just arrived. We just got here. Nostalgia, you fake, you bittersweet ache. The time that you take could make another heart whole. Could the truth be, I won't really see how much I love you till it's over. The pipes while I bring in the plants. places in place for September's dance. If you're willing, I'm willing to take one more chance. We just got here. Ooh, we just got here. Just arrived. We just just a minute ago, we were chasing June bugs in the moon glow. Fitting screens in the windows.